Hello everyone, today our presentation is going to be on understanding social location and how it impacts your role as a peer leader.
I'm Marcelin.
I'm Neda.
And Jabo.
And I'm Miles.
So a little about us, we are social work students entering our fourth year of the Direct Entry Program. We're also really good friends outside of the program. We're student leaders in the York community and beyond. And we are women of color from diverse walks of life.
So some learning outcomes from our presentation today. You'll be understanding your social location and how it impacts your role as a peer leader. We'll also be recognizing the power dynamics of service provider and service user relationships. We'll be exploring the historical oppression and its continuities. And finally, we will be discussing the importance of creating a safe space.
We'll begin by defining what is social location and why is it so important. Social location is made up of a combination of groups that people belong to, such as race, class, and sexual orientation. These factors shape how an individual perceives the world along with how they are positioned in this world. A person's position is heavily influenced by how they are treated by institutions and society. This is where we see historical and social factors playing a major role in a person's social location. It is essential to understand that these groups often intersect with one another to create multiple identities. Intersectionality is defined as a person or a group of people being affected by a number of disadvantages due to discrimination. It takes into account people's overlapping identities and experiences in order to understand the complexity of prejudices they face. So, for example, how would a Black male's social location impact how he perceives and is placed on the world? Reflect on the historical and social factors and think about how the effects of colonization impact his social location. Also consider, how would the effects of colonization impact someone from a dominant society? Would it also harm the dominant groups, or would they benefit from it in some way? This brings me to my next point. Social location is essential to understanding what positions we take up in society and how the groups we belong to have a set of rules and privileges or a lack of. When examining power and privilege, it is notable to highlight that people from privileged groups receive advantages regardless of whether they want them or are aware of them. When one becomes conscious of their particular privileges, it is essential that they use it for the betterment of others instead of for their own personal success. So if your white privilege allows you to be taken more seriously as an advocate, for instance, it is important that you understand that you stand in solidarity with social movements of the oppressed in order to achieve social justice. While understanding how your social location impacts you personally, it is also important to know how it impacts the people around you as their experience will be different from yours. It is also important to know how your social location impacts the way you interact with other students. This is why we'll be looking at how the relationship between reflexivity, intersectionality, and social location is fitting for this topic. So, reflexivity can be defined as the process of reflecting on your own personal biases and experiences that shape your thoughts, actions, and behaviors to help understand how you take up space when communicating with students. Why is this process so important? It is important because it helps you to understand your positions and the position of others in society. It is central to our growth as individuals and our relationship with others. The factors that make up our social location shape our attitudes, behaviors, and worldviews and experiences, and therefore, as a peer leader, it is important that you be reflective of how your position impacts your relationship with others. Are you using your privilege to guide other students? How do you take up space? Are you being mindful of the factors that shape their identity? These are some questions to consider when reflecting on your own social location. Having said that, reflexivity is seen as a tool for personal growth as it increases self-awareness and expands your knowledge about the experiences others go through. We are often socialized in the ideas that we carry, and practicing reflexivity allows us to go beyond what we know, what we were socialized and normalized to know. Everyone has a different lived experience, and your social location is complex and reflects many different identities. Allowing for growth gives a chance to step back and see the different perspectives of those around you. One way to better understand this is through a self-reflection exercise. So for this exercise, I'll ask for you to create a list of as many aspects of your identity that you can think of. After you complete your list, think of the top three aspects that shape your identity. And then finally, answer the following reflection questions. What identities do you think about the most and why? What identities do you think about the least and why? Why do you think some identities are invisible to you? What aspects of your identity give you privilege and what aspects do not? And finally, how can you use that privilege as a peer leader? And then to end this section off, we'll talk about some learning goals from the exercise. The first is to encourage peer leaders to explore the factors that impact one's identity. The next is to encourage conversation surrounding levels of privilege. For example, how male privilege is different for a white male versus a black male. Next is to gain an understanding of how some identities are important to some, but not to others. So for example, students that speak English do not consider language as an important part of their identity, but someone who has another first language may consider English to be a core part of their identity. And then finally is to let students reflect on the different experiences of their peers. This allows for students to become more empathetic and understanding when communicating with others, as they're aware of how people have different lived experiences.
Following discussion, we will be discussing service provider and service user relationships. In addition to your unique social locations and positions, in the fall, you will be adding the additional position of being a peer leader. As a peer leader, you hold a vital role at York as you will be supporting and assisting students. In your role as a peer leader, you will be providing different services, such as exam preparation, assistance with writing, as well as connecting students to a variety of resources. In essence, what this then makes you is a service provider, in turn making the student a service user. At its core, the service provider and service user relationship is intended to be a helping relationship. However, there are some complexities that may arise with this relationship. In order to put this into context, we could refer to the following scenario. A student comes to visit you during your office hours and expresses they are having difficulty with a course. Throughout your conversation, you realize you took the exact same course and also faced difficulties as well. What ended up helping you in the course was allocating more time to study and getting a tutor. Now I'm going to kindly ask that you pause the video just to reflect on this scenario to consider how having a shared experience or a similar experience to a service user can impact your overall interaction with the service user. Welcome back, and thank you for pausing and reflecting on that scenario. Based on that scenario, there are a variety of outcomes. But for the purpose of this research, we are going to be focusing on two. As noted on the first bullet point, one of the first outcomes that can occur is it can add to the interaction and benefit the relationship. Having a shared experience could allow the service user and service provider to have a shared understanding. This may also allow the service provider to provide tips that they found helpful in their own specific experience. However, on the other hand, as noted in the second bullet point, it can sometimes hinder the relationship. This is notable in the third and fourth bullet point, which states that while as a service provider, you may have a similar experience in context, it doesn't necessarily mean it is the same. This can be as a result of different factors and intersecting social locations and positions which can differentiate your experiences. For example, while a class may be difficult to you due to the amount of work that was required, for another student, the difficulty may be a result of not having access to internet at home or balancing a full-time job at school. Therefore, relating it back to the first possible outcome, the solutions or tips that you may offer may not actually be applicable to the student or the service user. This demonstrates how trying to be helpful can sometimes cause you to be unhelpful, because what may be helpful to you may not necessarily be helpful to someone else. This then arises the questions of what do I then do? Do I give tips? Should I refrain from giving tips? How do I help? And how do I become an effective helper? Of course, there are multiple answers and perspectives to address these questions. However, one thing you can keep in mind while working within a service user to service provider relationship is trying to focus solely on the service user wants, needs, and desires. Sometimes you may be able to identify it as the service user may be overt and state, "I need help with writing." Other times it may be difficult to dissect as they may not express within the situation what they want. In light of those situations, there is never an issue with asking the following two questions: how can I help, or how can I support you? By asking these questions, a service user may express that they want your advice, and at that point, you could feel free to give your advice. However, be mindful that your advice may not actually be applicable as noted in the scenario that we went over. What you can then do in that situation is mention that this is what worked for me, it may not necessarily work for you. This allows you to attend to the service user's needs because they did ask for your advice, but it also allows you to reinforce the fact that your situations and experiences may be different. Therefore, your advice may or may not be applicable for that particular service user. Also, other times, a service user may express that they just wanted to get a situation off their chest. Therefore, by literally allowing the student to talk, you already assisted them and met their desires, wants, and needs. Focusing solely on users' wants, needs, and desires is very important. Within the service provider to service user relationships, there are undeniable power imbalances. Normally, the service provider is seen as having more power within the relationship because they are seen as experts. This is also evident in your experience as a peer leader, as you are seen as an expert because you are an upper year student. However, it is imperative to keep in mind that you are not the expert in someone else's experiences, and you cannot necessarily define someone else's needs, desires, or wants. Within these relationships of a service user to a service provider, it is vital to balance expertise. Your expertise as an upper year student can be balanced by the expertise of a service user's experience of their own scenario.
Now on historical oppression and its continuities. Everyone has a past. History means different things for different people. It's important to pluralize history by saying histories, just as we pluralize community to be communities, because there is no one singular world history, but rather a multitude of histories. Oppression is a major part of some individuals' histories, and violence plays an integral role in some others. People of color have undergone oppressive events such as enslavement, colonialism, war, and genocide, and these histories have had profound contemporary impacts, the most notable of which is intergenerational trauma. This is a form of trauma that is quite literally passed down from generation to generation, as the psychological tolls of poverty, substance abuse, and systemic oppression take root in the children of those afflicted. Because of this, not everyone has the same start in life. Those with legacies of intergenerational trauma are less likely to succeed, not on account of their own merit, but due to systemic barriers to employment, education, and financial growth. And so in the context of peer leadership, it is important not only to render your own histories visible, but to be cognizant, and this term refers to critical consciousness of the histories of others so as to avoid perpetuating further systemic oppression in your role as a peer leader. Furthermore, it is essential that you educate yourself on your own histories and legacies, as well as the histories of others. So start learning today. And so with that, we have our first case study where you're going to apply all of those ideas and reflect on this. So Joshua is a 20-year-old Black man pursuing a major in social work. He is a peer leader and is passionate about community education and development. He grew up in a low-income neighborhood and was only ever able to secure low-paying entry-level jobs as a young man. Throughout his undergraduate career, Joshua has learned more about the history of slavery and colonialism in Canada and of the fact that his ancestors were forcibly removed from their home in Grenada as part of the transatlantic slave trade. How is Joshua's social location impacted by his history as a Black Canadian? In answering this question, you need to consider the continuities and intergenerational consequences of enslavement, the power of anti-racist education, the parallels between historical enslavement and contemporary oppressions faced by Black communities, and the relationship between poverty and barred access to opportunities. So please pause the video at this time while you reflect on this question. And now that you are done reflecting on Joshua's case study, let's move on to case study number two, Khadija and Karen. And so Khadija is a 19-year-old mechanical engineering student and a Syrian refugee who recently arrived in Canada. She is quickly picking up the English language, but struggles to take notes and focus in class due to gaps in her understanding. She finds it difficult to balance her Muslim faith with her academic studies, and her responsibilities at home make it nearly impossible for her to complete her homework on time.
No one at school knows what she's going through, and her poor grades are mistakenly attributed to her unwillingness to learn. She enrolls in the peer leadership program as a last resort and is matched with Karen, a 21-year-old white woman, as her peer academic leader. Think about how Karen can work to create a healthy environment for Khadija to thrive academically. And in reflecting on this question, we want you to consider the importance of educating oneself on your own histories and the histories of others, white privilege and how it can be used in the way of good, what a healthy service provider-service user relationship looks like, and the importance of creating safe spaces for students to communicate their feelings. Pause the video at this time and reflect on that.
So I will be discussing the importance of creating a safe space. As a peer leader, it's important to create a space that is welcoming for all students at York University. I'll be discussing why it's important to create a safe space for students. So we've broken down the word safe into different meanings based on its letters. S stands for safety, A stands for allyship, F stands for foster positivity and promotes open dialogue, and E stands for experienced by everyone. I will solely be focusing on the first three letters, which is safety, allyship, fosters positivity, and promotes open dialogue. But please keep in mind throughout this portion of the presentation that a safe space is experienced by everyone. So, to begin, a safe space is a climate that gives students the opportunity to feel secure and present to ask questions and express their views. A safe space allows a student to express their individuality respectfully to others. This notion of respect is a very important aspect of a safe space. The student, peer leader, or staff must be respectful to create a safe space. To encourage an open dialogue, this must be a conversation done with respect at its forefront. A safe space requires students to not only feel physically safe, but also emotionally safe enough to occupy a space without harm. Therefore, the S, which stands for safety, is a very important part in a safe space. A stands for allyship. An ally is an individual who speaks out and stands up for a person or a group that is targeted and discriminated against. An ally works to end oppression by supporting and advocating for people who are stigmatized, discriminated against, or treated unfairly. An allyship is a very important aspect of a safe space. This is because a safe space requires allyship, as we are all coming from various different social locations to share a space. Therefore, as a peer leader working at York University, it's important to use allyship at its forefront to create a safe space. F. This stands for fosters positivity and promotes an open dialogue. This is also a very important aspect of creating a safe space. A safe space fosters positivity, as I mentioned earlier, and it promotes identity growth. What I mean by that is that a safe space is an arena that allows for respectful dialogue. I keep reiterating that respectfulness and being a respectful peer leader is a very important aspect of creating a safe space. This is because an open dialogue requires understanding without judgment, as students may share their concerns and just work across that difference. If you're not being respectful throughout that process, it makes it very difficult to create a safe space for students, staff, and peer leaders. So this requires embracing and recognizing power dynamics in social location in relation to intersectionality. What I mean by that is that a peer leader, a staff member, and a student, we are all coming from different power dynamics and social locations. To work across that difference and create an open dialogue, this requires working through a lens of intersectionality. This requires recognizing and respecting boundaries. One way you can do that is listening to understand rather than listening to respond. A lot of the time, students are listening to respond to questions that are asked to them, but fostering positivity and promoting an open dialogue requires understanding. Therefore, when creating a safe space, understanding where students are coming from and meeting them where they're at is a very important aspect of creating a safe space. So, throughout this presentation, my colleagues and I have discussed various different learning outcomes that can help you through your role as a peer leader. The first aspect that we talked about is understanding your social location and how it impacts your role as a peer leader. We also discussed recognizing the power dynamics of service provider and service user relationships. We also explored understanding historical oppression and its continuities. And finally, as I mentioned, we talked about the importance of creating a safe space as a peer leader. I hope by the end of this presentation, you've left with more knowledge surrounding these topics. However, if you want to contact us and ask us any more questions regarding these topics or have an inquiry about any of the topics that we had today, please feel free to email us. We have listed our emails right here. We'd be more than happy to answer any questions that you may have. So once again, congratulations and thank you for listening to our presentation. Please don't hesitate to reach out and ask any questions, and wish you nothing but the best in the future. Thank you.